Welcome to the television ministry of Souls Harbor Tabernacle. We are located in the shadow of beautiful Crowder's Mountain, 271 Camp Rotary Road, Gastonia, North Carolina. Now be blessed by the anointed ministry of Pastor James Chambers and Church.
Well, praise the Lord. So good to have you with us tonight on this Saturday night TV program, Memorial Day weekend. We're so glad to have you. Hope you're having a safe, happy weekend if you're off, but don't forget to put the Lord in your weekend. Be at church in the morning if you're in town. If you're not in town, find a church. Amen. And have a good weekend in the Lord. I want to invite you to be with us at our church services. Our services Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, Sunday night at 6 o'clock, Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. We stream all our services, and all of it is on Facebook, so you can look and see programs that you miss or whatever. They're on Facebook. Souls Harbor Tabernacle, Gastonia. Have a wonderful church over in Dallas. Brother Eric Quinn is pastor there, along with his wife. They labor for the Lord, Arlene. And they'd be so glad to see you in the morning at 11 o'clock, tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. And their midweek service is Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. You'll be blessed by that church. Have another wonderful church up in Mooresburg. Brother Chuck Poole and his wife Joyce labor for the Lord there, and they'd be so glad to have you be with them. Their service times are 11 o'clock worship on Sunday, 6 o'clock on Sunday night, and Thursday night at 7 o'clock. And he and Joyce, his wife, would be glad to see you. Betty and I would be glad to see you at the Gaston Church. We'd just be delighted to know you visited one of the churches. We'd be glad to have you, and we appreciate you. I want you to call that number on the screen tonight. Brother Donnie will be by the phone. And we're just excited about what God's doing. Hope you have a good one. Want to make mention and the first song. We're going to have Sister Summer singing for you tonight. And Leisha Dockery used to come to church here when she was a little girl. She's a little handicapped girl. And that's not saying anything bad, but she stays mostly in her house. But they say when the program's on, she points to me and the people she knows here. Tommy and Betty, the people that she's known all of her life, says she goes in there and tells them to come in there and look because she knows it's somebody she knows. And we love all people, you know. And so we dedicate this to Leisha Dockery. I hope she loves to hear Summer sing, and Summer will be a blessing to her. Amen. So worship with us as Summer comes to sing. Call that number on the screen and talk to Donnie tonight and give you prayer requests. And we'll be back after Summer's song. Yes.
As they came out for the robe he wore, they chose the worldly trail. And they didn't think of eternity as the soldiers drove the nails. And will we I have
praise the Lord. I hope you enjoyed that song by Sister Summer tonight. I'll Take Jesus is a wonderful song, and I've sung that song probably for 30 years. I like it myself. So just worship with us tonight. I'd like to take a minute to ask you to write us, if you would. Include a love gift if you can. We ask people to stand with us if they would at $10 a month. If we had 100 people to do that, we'd never have to even say nothing about money. It would come in every time. And we're going to keep doing this for the Lord till Jesus comes, or till I wear out, or till he tells me not to do it. We're fixing in September to start our 20th year. We're just excited about what God's doing. So call that number, talk to Donnie. He'll pray with you if you need to right then and there. If you need some directions to either one of the churches, or if you'd like to talk to me or Brother Chuck or Brother Eric, you just give that to Donnie and we'll get the information when you're talking to him, or text it in anytime. Amen. And we just love to have you with us anytime. Pray that you'll be blessed tonight. We're going to have another song for you this time. This song is with our choir director, Brother Tommy, and his wife, Gail. And ready or not, the Lord is coming. And that's so true. Amen. We can drag around and miss it, or we can, you know, come to the fountain that's filled with blood drawn from Manuel's vein. It's up to you. Somebody get ready tonight. A holiday weekend when there's a lot of trouble going on in the land, be a good night for you to get saved. Worship with them as they sing for us at this time. Brother Tommy and Sister Gail.
Though the world says he's not coming, and they live like there's no end, it don't matter what the world says, ready or not, he's coming again.
Thank you.
enjoyed that song, and I pray that you'll be blessed by the word tonight. We're going to go to Joshua chapter 7, and it's a little bit lengthy, and so we got a little bit more time than we usually have. I'm going to read all 12 verses, and we don't have it on the board like we do on Sundays, but I'll try to stick with it and then come back and make some mention of what we got on here. Amen. But in Joshua chapter 7, verse 1 through 12, it says, "But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmah, and the son of Zadok, and the son of Zerah, the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. And Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Bethaven, on the east of Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, Go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said to him, Let not all the people go up, but about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor there, thither, for they are but a few. So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai smote of them about 36 men, and they chased them from before the gate unto Shebron, and smote them in the going down. Wherefore the hearts of the people melted because of the water. And Joshua rent his clothes and fell to the earth upon his face before the ark of the Lord until the eventide. He and the elders of the church and put dust upon their heads. And Joshua said, Alas, O Lord God, wherefore hast thou at all brought this people out of Jordan to deliver them into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us? Would to God we had been content and dwelled on the other side Jordan. O Lord, what shall I say when Israel turneth their backs before their enemies? For the Canaanites and the inhabitants of the land shall hear of it and shall environ around us and cut off our name from the earth. And what wilt thou do unto thy great name? And the Lord said unto Joshua, Get thee up. Wherefore liest thou thus upon thy face? Verse 11, Israel hath sinned. I'm preaching tonight, sin separates us. Israel hath sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have even taken of the accursed thing, and have also stolen and disassembled also, and they have put it even among their own stuff. Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before the enemies, but turned their backs before the enemies, because they were accursed. And the last line, listen to it. Neither will I be with you anymore, except you destroy the accursed thing among you. Father, bless the reading of this word, and we give you all the praise for it in Jesus' name. Sin separates. Amen. David said, if I regard iniquity in my heart, God will not hear me. So, you know, it will. There's a song talks about sin not entering into heaven. Sin will never enter there, it says. It will stop you at the door, bar you out forevermore. Sin will never enter there. It is definitely a separator. Amen. You know, we do so much, you know, just like, you know, that those in the Bible, like Joshua, thought he could just shake himself and everything would be all right. But I'm telling you, when we've sinned, there's not but one thing that works. That's why John the Baptist was so hated, because he said, repent, repent. He told them repeatedly to repent. Until they were ready to repent, there was nothing he could do for them. And, you know, we pray over people. You know, we do everything we can for people. But I'm telling you, God will not make you go against your will. He'll just make you willing to go. Found that out with Jonah. And I'm here to tell you tonight, that's the truth. But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. I don't think that maybe at the time, and I'm not a Bible scholar, I'm a Bible student, but I think that the time that maybe Joshua was praying, he really didn't know what happened. And I think that God knew all along what happened, and maybe Joshua knew, maybe he didn't. But immediately when things went wrong, he did as most people do today. We start blaming God, you know. I was going to church doing good, and my son got killed, and so I quit church. I ain't going back to church no more. Well, you're mad at the wrong one. Amen. If you get mad at God, if you try to stop God. Many people said, well, if I could have just hadn't lost my car, I'd still been going to church so far. But nobody seemed to care. God didn't care, and I lost my car. If I hadn't had to move out of my house, I mean, the list goes on and on and on all night, and we can blame God. And that should not ever be the first thing we do. When something goes wrong, we should look in the mirror. We should look at the man in the mirror, the woman in the mirror, and say, God, what have I done? The prophets made the statement, and it wasn't that they were full of sin. It wasn't that they thought they were holier than thou. But they made statements like, search me, O Lord, and see if there's any wicked way found in me. And then it made statements like, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God. And after you've done all of that, then you don't know anything. Then you say, God, I don't understand this trial. And you won't be the first person that said that. I know of at least one song says that. But you won't be the first one. You won't be the last one. I can tell you there's times that I have not understood it all. And there's times that I questioned when I shouldn't have. And there's times when I just said, God, you know more about this than I do. You see the whole picture. I see a small portion of the picture. But he began to blame God. You notice how they got to this portion. Let me go back just a little bit. They had such a great victory at Jericho that they thought this was going to be the world eternal piece of cake. This will not be no problem. And I think that a couple things were wrong here. I think one thing is they begin to take the credit. We did such a good job. We're not going to take all the men. They're not as big as Jericho. And we didn't do anything but walk around that. The truth is they didn't do nothing but obey God. They didn't do nothing but obey God. They obeyed God. And they were honest and sincere with God and did that. They obeyed God. If you read, and I preached recently at my church, and on the message about when you're supposed to shout. They shouted at the right time. They walked at the right time. They did exactly the numbers that God told them to do. You know, when they walk around, I'm not going to preach that tonight. I might at church tomorrow. But I just want you to understand that they did everything as God had said. Amen. And you, if you do that, you know, I preached one night. I remember who it was, but I won't call their name. I ordained somebody one night, and I preached about Noah building the ark. And, you know, all of that stuff wouldn't have made no sense to me. You know, how much feet there was between one floor and the other, and how big it was. And it was like a yacht that a sailboat would have held those 8 people. Somebody hear me. A good-sized boat would have took 2 of about every animal they had back there in. They had been cramped, but God wanted it like he wanted it. And I think sometimes we just subvert the plan of God. We just think that it doesn't matter. And then when we get the victory, when we have a victory over, we get back and we say things like, I don't understand why that, you know, why this other one didn't work. You know, we did that when we didn't do nothing. I've told a story so many times about one year Betty and I planted a garden with her mother. We were just married, and I can tell you, I knew a little something. I knew nothing about gardening now. But when we got married, when I was 19, I just growed up, and I'd had all the years of putting the tomatoes in the ground and planting the corn. Here, my daddy said, you put it too thick, not thick enough. I knew how to do that because my dad had trained me. And I went back, and I fixed it just like they said, and we planted a bunch of little rows. It might have been 20 by 20 or 15 by 30. It wasn't a big garden at all. It was just about like this section of pews right here in front of me or less. And we got down there, and I don't ever forget. See, they're not the only one of the people that ever does that. We people do that today. If I'm not careful, I'll do that every once in a while. I'll get too much confidence in myself when the Bible says, he that thinketh he standeth, better take heed lest he fall. Right. And we prayed over that garden. And I got down on my knees while I was putting that dirt around the plants. And I said, Father, I said, this is a little garden. And if we had to go on what this is supposed to produce, we won't have nothing here. It's so small. And I'm telling you, we couldn't give it all away. Yeah. We could not give it all away. That was maybe the first summer that was married, probably 72, maybe 73, somewhere along in there. And we planted that garden. It was when I was getting serious with God. Somebody hear me. You get serious with God, God will get serious with you. And I said, we couldn't give it away. Next year, I had not forgot that prayer, and I had not forgot giving God the glory. I testified to everybody about him doing it. But I remember getting down there and saying to her, let's plow the whole field up. And it was, the whole field was as big as this church sanctuary. It might have shaped a little different, but it was this many feet, I'm sure. I said, let's plow this whole field. And I remember saying things like, we'll have to sell that stuff. We can't give all that away. And we didn't get as much as we did out of that little garden the year before. And after it was over, God said, you didn't ask me to bless this one. You didn't ask me to bless this one. And for whatever reason, God's good to us. And he throws handfuls out on purpose. But you follow the plan of God. And I went from 1 year of bragging and giving God all the credit to the next year of saying, look at this big garden. We're going to have some much stuff. Like the rich man, you know, I got so much goods, I don't know what to do with them. But you got to be careful there. I'm going to stick to my point. Sin will separate. So they go on down there. They do it. They fall on their face. And then Joshua gets back and starts complaining to God and telling God. And God listens to it for a long time. He said, what's people going to say about you, God? Ain't nobody going to have confidence in me. I mean, I'm just talking Belmont talk. But nobody going to have any confidence in me. I won't be able to do nothing now after this big mistake. I don't know why you let this happen. And along about verse 8 or 9, the Bible said that verse 10 goes down 10 verses before God has to just knock them down and get their attention. And God said, Joshua, get up. Why are you lying on the ground? I mean, I feel like God, you say God don't talk like that. He does to me. Because I don't speak Spanish and I don't speak French. And those, you know, if God says something in French, you know, if he didn't reveal it to me, I wouldn't know what he said. But he talks where I can understand it to me.
Right.
And I'm sure he speaks French and Spanish to those that need to, because God can do anything. He's omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. But I want to tell you tonight, down to verse 10, he said, get up, why are you lying on the ground? And then God didn't ask him, you knew what happened. He said, get up, why are you laying on the ground? Israel have sinned, and they have transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have even taken of the accursed thing, and have also stolen and disassembled also, and they have put it even among their own stuff. Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before the enemies, but they turned their backs before their enemies because they were a curse, because they had sin in the camp. Amen. We got about 4 minutes. I'm going to ask Betty to make her way over to music. And when we get down to about 2 minutes, maybe to play something, and I'll pray, play softly. And I'm just about through here. But I want to tell you tonight, there's a couple things there that fits the world so bad. He said, get up. Why are you laying there blaming me in verse 10? Verse 11, he said, Israel have sinned. And they took things that they shouldn't have took because I told them not to take it. And they took it anyway. Somebody hear me tonight.
Right.
They took it anyway. And they've sinned. And they've transgressed my covenant. They have taken the accursed thing. They have stolen. They have also stolen. You know, everybody's quick, preachers that want you to pay your tithes, and I think you should. I believe in tithing. I really do. And I preach it. I don't preach whole subjects on it. I don't ask people if they're going to pay their tithes. When I ask them if they're going to serve God, if you serve God, you'll pay your tithes. Amen? But I just, you know, they've stolen. They took things they shouldn't take. We think there's nothing wrong with that anymore. Amen? They couldn't stand before that. I don't want to miss this line. And they put that stuff among their own stuff. And we think sometimes when it's in our stuff, I mean, if you got an ink pen that you stole, God knows those 20 ink pens are yours, but that one you stole. And I'm not talking about being legalistic and say, you know, if somebody gives you something, forget it back. You didn't steal it. That ain't what I'm talking about. You know, if you take one home every day and you got more in your drawer at home than you got in your drawer at work, you didn't pay for none of them, and nobody didn't give you permission, well, church or whatever it is, it's the same thing. You put it among your stuff, and then you don't remember where you got that and where you got that one. You got stolen stuff mixed in with it, and it won't work. They turned their backs on their enemies because they were cursed, because they sinned. Neither will I be with you anymore except you destroy the cursed thing. Hear me tonight. Unless you get rid of the sin, it separates you. It bars you at the door. It just gets you where you can't work for God anymore. We've got about 2 minutes left. And I just want to tell you that I love you tonight. I mean, as we go off the air tonight, sometimes I preach and holler, and I just don't feel like I was supposed to holler tonight. I need to preach a little bit and tell you a little something, teach a little bit, tell you what you need to do. I feel like it was good. I feel like, as Donnie says about some of the programs, I think this message is a keeper. I think it's what you need to hear tonight. And I'm telling you, as you celebrate this weekend, and we won't be back next week, you say, well, I won't listen to him no more. You won't get a chance to on TV till 2 weeks from tonight. But I wish you would. Don't get mad at the messenger. I'm telling you what the Bible said. Sin will separate you. Father, I pray right now that in Jesus' name, you'll help somebody to come to you tonight. Help us all to be saved, and all of us to be saved during Memorial Day. Keep the record clean, Lord. If we fish, if we vacation, if we're at the beach or the mountain, it's not a geographic thing, it's you. What you gonna do? I can live right at the beach, I can live right at the mountain. I can live right at church, I can live right at home. But it's up to you. God bless you. Thank you for calling in tonight. New people, we appreciate you. We're getting them every week. We thank you. God bless you. We got about 35 seconds left. Any sing us a verse of that song, maybe a verse of the chorus. It'll take you further.
Want to go?
Amen.
Slowly, but holy.
Amen.
Taking control.
God bless you. We're down to a few seconds. Have a good night. Good weekend. See you at the church in the morning. Happy Memorial Day.
That you want to stay.
Thank you for joining us on the telecast. Pastor Chambers, wife Betty, and entire congregation welcome you to any of our exciting services. Morning worship, 11 a.m., Sunday evening, 6 p.m., and Wednesday at 7. Tune in next time.